Hey, good morning, all you beautiful ones. Bless you. I see you up there, high and lifted up. Yes, in the high places. It's kind of fun up there, isn't it? You feel close, but you kind of can have your own private place, depending where you sit. So good. Wow. Man, it's a great day. It's a great day. We were celebrating or acknowledging, I don't know if you celebrate Memorial Day. When I was a child, my first memories of Memorial Day with my father and mother, we would drive up into some mountains in southern Idaho. Don't ask me exactly where, but it's where my grandfather was buried. Anyway, we'd go there and my dad would put flags on the graves, and that was Memorial Day. That was my first impression of it, and it was a remembrance of people that have sacrificed their lives. And so it is, you know, in our culture, it's kind of like it's the beginning of summer, and it's like, you know, summer's here, and the time is right for dancing in the street, or, you know, V-A-C-A-T-I-O-N, if you're old enough to remember that. You know, it's actually kind of this remembrance and gratitude. And so we do acknowledge that, and that it's a tremendous sacrifice that people make. What's amazing for us as we don't sorrow with those who have no hope, but we have like this living hope in Jesus Christ. And so we actually realize that our entire life and our civilization and everything that we have is all the result of one life given as a sacrifice, the donation, the full donation of Jesus Christ on the cross. And that since he died and defeated death and rose again, that actually the whole world for the last 2,000 years has been being impacted by those who give their lives to him, and many ultimately give their lives for him. And so, you know, some are martyrs who give their life in the full measure of their devotion in a mission field or in a persecution situation. There actually have been more Christian martyrs in the last couple of years than in all history before that. We don't even realize that because we live in this American pop culture bubble where, you know, the problem is if you have an iPhone 10 or if you're still stuck with, you know, I mean, it's like our values are so superficial, driven by a culture of media and consumerism and that kind of thing. And the good news is, not I'm laying like, oh man, it's depressing, let's all go home now. No, but that when we have an encounter with Jesus Christ, it releases a transformation in us that not only transforms who we are, but ultimately brings transformation to the whole world as a gift. So his gift still continues to give in me and you. And that, it's just, what an amazing thing. And this is what we remember every time we have communion, every time we worship together. And I loved it. I mean, it's been quoted already once, but I love what Ricardo said on the video. You know, an experience will give you a buzz. And many of us have been buzzed at some point in our life. But an encounter changes everything. An encounter transforms us. And so I'm so thankful 46 years ago I had an encounter with Jesus Christ. Though I knew who he was, I'd heard about him, but never met him. And then met him in an encounter that started something that has transformed my internal world, which is releasing transformation into the world around me and ultimately to the nations. So why am I saying all that? Today we're going to be receiving our Lifelines offering, you know, which we do this. I think we're sometimes awkward about receiving a big special offering, and we just do this. We do this during the first fruits offering, and the testimonies are just blow our minds all year long. We keep hearing more and more testimonies, but then we do this once a year in the spring, usually right around now at the end of May. And it's how we just increase our giving into those who are out in the mission field changing the world in places we can. And actually, in our giving, we become participants, partners with them. So today we're going to be receiving this Lifelines offering, and it's our donation that changes the whole world. I mean, it's like, you know, we can think like, oh no, I don't want to go to church, they're going to have the mission offering. We used to do this once a month, but we felt like it, we love to focus on it. And last week, Brian gave this amazing message, as only Brian can, and highlighted some of our ways we reach out to the world, some of our missions. And then on this last Wednesday night, some of our missionaries shared, you know, most of them have a local focus, like changing the city around us and the world around us. But here's the amazing thing is, as we give today, you know, we're participating and partnering with all the missionaries that we have around the world. I mean, that's wild, huh? It's kind of like, I mean, these aren't so popular now, but in the 80s, mutual funds were like a real big investment vehicle, and they were rising quickly, and so everybody was trying to get rich quick with mutual funds. But and people still use funds and all that thing, but what happens in a mutual fund is you put your money in, and it gets distributed to all these different opportunities, hopefully which bring you back some kind of return better than you would get someplace else. So when we give into a Lifeline offering, it's like it gets distributed to all these different missionaries in harvest fields around the world, and people rescuing child soldiers, people caring for orphans and the poor, people preaching the raw gospel in places where they could get killed for it. You know, and some of our missionaries, we can't talk about them very much, but, you know, give many details, because now through the internet and through live streaming, you know, it puts them at risk. I love it. So, you know, when you participate in the Lifelines offering today, you're investing in a kingdom mutual fund that brings back returns for all eternity. And one day you may be, you know, in eternity, meet somebody that you never met in this world, but they were reached by the donation that you give, you know, and the world is changed by that. Is that an amazing opportunity? I mean, it's just like, whoa, you know. So, and I just want, and I really want to encourage all the, like, if you're young and you think like, well, you know, I'm a teenager, I don't have much money. It does, you know, it's like the widow's mite. That little investment you make today, which may be sacrificial for you, it's going to bring fruit for all eternity and change the world. Well, everybody's getting kind of quiet. So I'm going to tell a joke. No, I'm not. Not today. I'm not going to tell a joke. But so basically, God gives us this opportunity to partner with him in changing the whole world. And it's easy to get depressed. I mean, by headlines, by news. I fight a battle often during the week. I'll see headlines or I'll see the way something is reported, and I think like, oh God, are we losing the battle? And if I just read the New York Times, or I just read the LA Times or the Chicago Tribune or the Harrisburg Patriot News, I might think we're losing the battle. But we're not losing the battle, and the truth is eternal. And it tells us that of his government and peace, the increase of his government and peace, there's no end. And the truth is that there have been more baptisms this year than any year in history. You know, and the rate of people getting born again around the world is higher than the death rate of people around the world. Hooray! You know, but it doesn't, anyway. So we are participating in something that not only will change the world, but is already changing the world. And all of us are the recipients of past generations who've given their lives for the sake of the gospel. Whether they gave their life as a martyr in their death, or they lived their life as a witness all of their lifetime and died at a ripe old age, but full of good fruit and good testimony. By the way, did you know the word witness and martyr are the same word? In the New Testament. So you don't have to die to be a martyr. You just have to die to your selfishness and live your life completely sold out for Jesus Christ. Then if someone happens to take your life, you'll have no fear because perfect fear casts out love, and you'll step into a great reward in eternity. Amazing. All right. So God's strategy has always been a strategy of joy. And the title of this message is Making the Nations Glad. That's what we're going to do today in the offering. And by the way, there's no pressure on this, but I'm going to talk about it because that's like the ministry time today is we're making a donation to change the world. And hopefully you've prayed about it and you paid attention. If you're a visitor, there's never any pressure on this. We just want it to be something you do with joy and gladness. And Lord, speak to us. If anybody came and they're unprepared, like, what? I didn't know about this. That you would just speak clearly, that we'd hear from you, and our hearts would respond with joy and gladness. Amen, in Jesus' name. So God, imagine God who created the entire universe, and in the universe he created the solar system with our sun, and in the solar system he put 8 planets, used to be 9, but now there's like 8.5 planets because Pluto's only a half planet, but they're revolving around the sun, and on the third rock around the sun, he created all the conditions for life, and then he created us as the crown of his creation in his image and likeness to rule first planet Earth, but ultimately the entire universe with his image and likeness. Amazing, but then it went south. Because he gave us free will and we chose the wrong door. And so Adam and Eve fell and death came into the world. I'm making this really simple because we're kind of simple. No, I mean, it just takes too long to make it full blown. But the short story is, after a while, everybody was bad. And so into this bad world, God picked one person and said, I'll start with this guy. His name was Abram. He was an idol worshiper and an idol maker in Ur of the Chaldees, which is approximately part of Iraq today. And here's how it works out. This is how God says, I'm going to fix it. Hey, and you know how he does it? By blessing a person. So God's blessing on you isn't an option. It's a prerequisite to being a force that changes the world around you. Genesis 12:1. Now the Lord said to Abram, he wasn't even Abraham yet, he got his ha later, because that was like the spirit of God, and Abram became Abraham, and the father of many nations. And the Lord said to Abram, go from your country, your kindred, your father's house, your culture that you know, to the land I'll show you. And verse 2, this is really important, I will make, say make, I know, oh, thank you. You guys, you could get a cynical attitude like, the preacher says, say make, I'm not going to say it. Okay. Thank you very much for not being cynical. Okay, and I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you. Now, here's what I want to point out. Both, God said, I will make, and I will bless. Making is creating. Blessing is also creative. See, without... So God is going to make and bless. That's by divine gift. And then he said, I will make your name great so that you will be a blessing. So just like God said, let there be light, and light was. You know, it's like God said, light be, and be light. You know, it's like, so God said, I will bless you, and I will make you a blessing, and you will be a blessing. So you is a blessing. See, that's what I'm saying. It's like the fact that blessing of God on your life is a creative state, that God is creating something in you that needs to get to the whole world. That's how, when he says you will be a blessing, he means you'll be a fountain of transformation in the world around you. Oh my gosh. So there's the creative word, and then there's the effect of the creative word. And he said, you're in Genesis 22, speaking now, he's Abraham, in your seed or in your offspring, all the nations of the earth will be blessed. So what God said, Abraham, I did something to you. It is now in your DNA, and in your seed, your descendants will become the source of blessing to the entire world. Now you have been blessed with every blessing in heavenly places. Ephesians chapter 1. If you believe, then you are the children of Abraham, who's the father of all who believe. So do you trust God? Oh, good. Okay, the worship hasn't worn off yet. You still trust God? You still think like, you know, if I'm blind, I'll see and everything will be all right. By the way, all right, we usually use all right like mediocre. How's the food? It's all right. That means it's not so bad that I'm gagging it up, but I don't know if I would come back here again. But that's not what all right in this song means. All right in that song means everything is great. So when he opens our eyes, he makes us all right. Not like we're right and everyone else is wrong, but we are completely right with how we were meant to be. Okay, now, so we're going to change the world, but how are we going to do it? First, we have to be blessed. Psalm 67, this is the most amazing strategy in the world. It's a strategy of blessing and joy. You're blessed to be a blessing. Listen, Psalm 67, may God be gracious to us. Has anybody ever experienced any kindness in your life? It came from God. He was being gracious to you. May God be gracious to us and bless us. See, if he's just gracious to you, that makes it good. But when he blesses you, it makes you powerful. It's his power at work in you. But to will and to do what he wants to have happen is good pleasure. May God be gracious to us and bless us and make his face to shine upon us, which means his presence is on you to such a degree that you're shiny. Right? I mean, some of you, I'm looking out, I've seen some shiny people. I don't want you to be the dimmest bulb in the box, okay? So, right? I want you to be bright, full of his light. May God be gracious and bless us. Make his face, his presence, shine on us. This is the prerequisite for being a blessing, for changing the world. And that's why right after that it says Selah. Selah means take a break and let it sink in. I mean, we actually, you know, there's different interpretations. Selah, one is that it was a musical interlude in the singing of the Psalms. Another translation, this is if you have the Amplified, it says stop and think about it. I like that one. You know, let it sink in, like meditate on it, contemplate, like, oh God, this is real. And don't move on until you've got that piece. Okay. Verse 2, because this is why, so that, I'm adding the so, your way may be known on the earth. Your saving power, which is a translation of the Hebrew word Yeshua, which we know this name as Jesus, okay, so that your Yeshua be known among all nations. By the way, it says all, it doesn't say most. It says all, not most. So we want Tibet to know, we want Nepal to know, we want Rwanda to know, we want Ecuador to know, we want all the nations to know how good he is. So they would know his way, we can't show his way if we're not blessed. So that's why it's our obligation to be blessed. I'm gonna have an altar call for people who wanna repent of not being blessed. And just come up and say, I've been miserable. I am sorry, God. That is a sin. You told me that I was blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. I'm going to stop complaining. I'm going to stop groaning. And I'm stop being jealous. I'm going to just be blessed. Okay, so now, the altar call will be later. Okay, now, But this is prerequisite. If we don't get this, we'll never change the world. Now, the outcome of that is that we release something that brings joy, and it also brings justice and good government into the world. Let's read verse 3. Let all the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Now, they can't praise him if they don't know how good he is, because praise means to celebrate. So what David is seeing here, assuming David wrote this, but maybe it was one of the other songwriters in the band there in the Tabernacle of David, they're all going, maybe we want everybody on earth to go, God is amazing, yeah, yeah, yeah. That's what it means to celebrate, to praise. Let all the people praise you. Notice it doesn't say most. All right, so we've got our work cut out for us. Then it says, now here's the impact of it. Verse 4, let all nations, every culture, every ethnic group be glad. So if you're looking around, you see some sad people, they're the mission field. Let all nations, let the nations be glad and sing for joy. Now, I would sing for joy right now, but I don't have a solo quality voice, so I'll just use your imagination. Kind of like, well, take your pick. Bing Crosby, no, I don't know. Okay, Paul McCartney, I have no idea. Okay, let the nations be glad, not Kurt Cobain, I'm sure of that. Okay, be glad and sing for joy, for you will judge the people with equity and guide the nations on earth. Now, this sounds like, oh, those Christians, they believe in a theocracy, they want a dictatorship by God. Well, I'm going to set you free, in case anyone ever says that to you. For you will judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon the earth. How will he do that? He will do that through his people. He will. How many here are part of the body of Christ? Okay. Well, very good. Some aren't, some are, some didn't. It's like, I'm not sure. I'm not raising my hand. It might be a trick question, but it's like, wait, it's not a trick question. Okay, he's going to judge the people with equity. How will he do that? By having godly judges. By having people in positions of government who have the heart of God and the mind of Christ. And he will guide the nations upon the earth. This is going to make everybody happy. Verse 5, let all the people praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. So God is after joy. Why are we giving this offering today? We're going to change the world. We're going to make the nations glad. Now, it might not happen next week, but it will happen. And there, not only that, it's not just restricted to people. It's all of creation. Verse 6, the earth has yielded its increase. See, here's what's happened. They began to write this song. They began to see it and experience it. They went out into the future, and they saw there will be a day when all the earth will yield its full potential. Come on. It's yielded its increase. God our God shall bless us. God shall bless us. Let all the ends of the earth shall fear him. So when God totally transforms a people and their understanding and the laws they make and the way they govern, not only is every person made glad, but even the way we do agriculture, the way we steward the earth, the way we treat the planet, the way we treat other beings, other creatures, becomes like heaven on earth, and all the earth is like, there is so much wealth in the earth. There's so much potential. There's so much blessing that can come right out of the soil, right out of your cow, right out of your chicken, if they're treated the way God would treat them. I'm serious. It sounds cute and funny, but it's not. It's like, we think that there's a problem, and there's sterility and all this stuff, and we don't need to add chemicals. We need to add God's blessing. Okay. I know I'm getting on thin ice here in some people's eyes, but I probably would never be chosen as the chaplain for Monsanto Corporation. But somebody else would have that calling. But so how this works is it starts with personal transformation. We encounter the love of God. It releases something in it that changes everything. Love opens our eyes. We start loving the people around us. This is the beginning of missions. And what's amazing is that little bit that we can do is actually enough to change the whole world. Now, not in 5 minutes, right? Maybe in 5 generations, we don't know. I mean, I don't know when the Great Commission will be fulfilled, but I know that it's possible, and it doesn't take much. Isn't that amazing? I was reading Matthew 14, and I said, oh, this is just how it is. It's like, we're looking at this big mess, and Jesus says, give them food. We're going, wow, we don't have anything. He says, well, what do you have? They say, well, we have 5 little barley loaves and 2 little fishes. And he goes, that's fine, give them to me. We give them to him, he takes it, he blesses it, he breaks it, and he distributes it, and they were all fed and satisfied, and there was leftover. What if God takes this little bit of our love, our participation, our blessing, our generosity, and he takes it and blesses it and distributes it, and it feeds everybody because it's miraculous. What we're sowing not into our own ability, that's called paying taxes, but we're sowing into something supernatural that's ruled over by love. And that has miraculous multiplication. Now, and what's amazing is as we participate in something like this, it's not just that we give money to missionaries, we become missionaries. Not just out there, but where you are. Because God is busy transforming the world and making the nations glad. And that's what missions is. Now, so I'm going to give you quickly a tale of two civilizations. I'm going to compare the effect of the gospel and the effect of Islam, okay? And for any Muslims that are visiting here, I love Muslim people. There's some of very, very beautiful people I know and who are my friends that are this. But I'm comparing the message of Jesus Christ and the message that came through the Prophet Muhammad and its impact on civilization. So 1,000 years ago, now remember, we're going to make the nations glad. 1,000 years ago, Islamic civilization was in kind of a peak period, and the rulers were wealthier, the armies were more powerful, the scholars were more advanced, and it seemed like Europe, which was kind of in the backwaters, they're all raising pigs and dying of the Black Plague and all this stuff, that it was just going to get swallowed up by Islam. In fact, about every 500 years, it seems like there's a threat on this happening. But here's what's so amazing. Something totally changed. And right now, in this time, the little country of Spain translates more books into Spanish than have been in 1 year than have been translated into Arabic in hundreds of years. It's like, whoa, that's kind of interesting. And then the little tiny country of Finland, which only has 5 million people, and there's a lot of big problem with alcoholism in Finland, you know, so it's like, and it's way north and the sun hardly ever shines there, but it's number 42 in national economic complexity and production in the whole world. And last year, the 5 million people of Finland exported more goods and services to bless the people around them than all the 165 million who speak Arabic in the whole world. Now this isn't like I'm, oh great, you know, he's a big European white guy, you know, and he's saying all this stuff. No, I'm talking about the impact of the gospel on a culture. And that's only if we take oil out of the equation. Because if we put oil back in the equation, then some of the Arab countries exceed that. But why would I take oil out of the equation? I just wanted you to see wherever the gospel goes, it leaves a residual blessing that doesn't just bless the good people, it blesses everybody. You know what I'm saying? It's like it changes the culture. It makes the culture glad. And so why would I want to take oil out of the equation? Because that's a big part. That's important. Yes, it is. But did you know oil was discovered by the British who were carrying a worldview and a scientific capacity that came through the impact of the gospel on their nation, and that it was the distilling and distribution process was actually developed by American engineers. And to a great degree, the distribution of it, the peaceful distribution around the world, has been protected by the American military, which by no means is perfect, but is protecting tyrants and radicals from using that petroleum energy as a weapon against the rest of the world. Amazing. Okay, I'm not on a political campaign here, but the West, which was 1,000 years ago, if you were voting, like, who's going to win? Oh, you would say for sure the Ottoman Turks are going to win, or the Arabs are going to win. And it's like, no, this little besieged backwater has been continually impacted by the gospel. And what is behind the rise of the West? And here's what it was. The gospel saturated those very pagan places. You know, Germany and France and all those places, they didn't start out Christian. They were really pagan. Lots of missionaries were martyred and killed, evangelizing the Celts. You know, there were warlike people. But they got changed, and their culture got changed by the effect of the gospel. Was it perfect? Absolutely not. Is it making the world a better place? Yes, it is. It's amazing. And so, like, well, how? Okay, I'm glad you asked me. And so I've studied this stuff, and some of this I've said before, but I just want to repeat it. Like, here is, I mean, every time the gospel goes someplace, it not only impacts the people who meet Jesus, who get saved, who will spend eternity in heaven, it actually has an impact on everyone around them. And so, like, how? Okay, let's just start. Here's at least 10 areas that people are transformed. And actually, many of you are drawn into this because there's something inside you that is being energized by God to change the world, to kind of brighten the corner where you are, you know, and let your light shine in your neighborhood. Okay, number one, here's so significant, music. Well, you mean other cultures don't have music? Yes, they do, but nowhere has music been developed and just brought into a fullness like it was in this cradle of Western civilization. And so here's just an, because the Bible is full of music. The gospel tells us to make melody in our hearts unto the Lord, to sing and make music to God rather than getting drunk and partying, you know. And so, and I mean, isn't it amazing that where radical Islam goes, music gets stomped out? They don't like it. No, I mean, there's music, there's beautiful music that's come out of all of these cultures, but it's been developed into this massive, rich tradition in the West, which is now going all over the world through because of the internet and pop culture. And so in many cultures, they're saying, well, you know, all our young people are being Westernized. A big vehicle of that is through music. It's not like we're against indigenous cultures, but there's actually music in the human soul. Only humans make music. Birds sing, but they sing the same songs they were singing 6,000 years ago, and they may alter a little bit if they're in an isolated group, but basically a lark is a lark, a robin is a robin, and they've been sounding the same for thousands of years. Whereas in the Gospels and the Psalms tell us to make a new song to the Lord. And so this developed a whole theology. Augustine, or Saint Augustine, if however you want to say it, Augustine and Augustine, was a professor of Greek philosophy before he became a Christian. He was a big skeptic and a big unbeliever, and then he became a Christian. He was a powerful mind, and he took a lot of the Greek theology, which saw music as mathematical and that it's somehow embedded into the very mathematic order of creation, and he understood it as for the glory of God, and so he took it into worship. And so it turns out that in the 900s, the 10th century, in backwater England, this group of Benedictine monks was studying all this, and they got so inspired and they wanted to glorify God with music that they got together and they built what at that time was the world's largest pipe organ. It had 400 pipes. It took 70 men to work 26 bellows to feed the air pressure into this organ so it could be played in the cathedral, the small stone cathedral they had built there in Winchester, which has since been replaced by a big cathedral, and to the glory of God. And when they played this pipe organ, that people could hear it for miles around, or maybe a mile around, they could hear that sound being raised for the glory of God. I mean, it's just an amazing thing. So it's not only music, it's all the arts that are released for the glory of God. When God, the gospel comes and says, you're made in the image and likeness of God, you're a child of God, be creative because your Father in heaven is creative. And make music because heaven is filled with music, you know? And so, I mean, do you understand technologically, like if you ever, you can Google it, look at how a pipe organ works, it blows your mind. It's very complicated, you know? And they were doing it like with little wooden blocks with holes drilled in them that had to be moved by leathers, connected by leather straps. And I mean, just the devotion and the brilliance, the engineering, the technology, the mathematics that went into designing the tubes, putting the notches in the right places so they could go bom, 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 bom. Of course, Beethoven hadn't lived yet, but I mean, they're just playing music to the glory of God. It's wherever you go, and some of you are drawn to that, and people, it's amazing. God is sending musicianaries all over the world, including into your office and your school, and just let it, you know, worship music is part of making the nations glad. Amen? Amen. Okay, number two, I'll do this quickly, otherwise, you know, I don't know. The picnic might be late today or something, but okay. Just creativity in general, that we understand we're created in the image and likeness of God, and if you're human, you are creative. And it's part of being a human that when we see something, we imagine, how could this be better? How could I fix this? Maybe I could make something that would make this easier. Any of you feel drawn to creativity? A few, yeah, good, good, good. How about music? I didn't do the hands for music. So God, I just release the Holy Spirit of creativity and worship upon your people. When we think of creativity, we usually think of fine arts, you know, painting and ballet, and that's performing arts. Painting and sculpture and music are the fine arts. And those are great, but how many are glad just for technological creativity? Are there any women here that wish every dishwasher in the earth just evaporated and you could just wash your dishes and dry them like we did in the 50s? Anybody here? Okay, nobody's an enemy of dishwashers. Isn't that amazing? Because somebody said, you know, people have better things to do with their life than spending all the time washing dishes, even though when we were kids, it was a big part of our training. Who was washing, who was drying, you know? And we spent time talking to each other, but we love it. Put it in, close it, and they even make like silent dishwashers. Ours is really quiet. You push the button, you hardly know. It's running for a really long time, but you hardly know it. Our old dishwasher was like, and we had to like figure out, okay, are we leaving the house? Okay, we'll run the dishwasher. Because otherwise it was like having a cement mixer in our house. But I just thank God for creativity. Amen. Technology used for the glory of God. Eyeglasses, mechanical clocks, they were all developed. Eyeglasses actually were developed under the requests of monks who were copying the scriptures in scriptoriums, which is like what it sounds like. It's a place where they wrote and they copied the scriptures because the printing press hadn't been invented yet, which would be another technological blessing that would bless the whole world. But like because they wanted these, the glassmakers in Murano, on the island of Murano in Italy, started making lenses, and they said, yeah, now these old monks whose eyes were getting old and they couldn't see, their arms weren't long enough, they go, I can see again, I can write. It made them happy, and everybody started hearing about it. And then they said, why don't you take two of these and put little wires around them, and that way, you know, we have two hands to work with. And all over Europe in the 1300s, in the 14th century, eyeglasses were the rage. You know, it's like smartphones today, you know? It's like, hey, I can see, you know? And, but it's like God releases creativity and technology. Do you understand this? This is wild. That's why this is, how did the West ascend? By releasing the image of God. Translations, you know, the scriptures were in ancient languages. The Quran is still in 7th century Arabic. And if you translate it, it's no longer the Quran. It's a translation of the Quran. And so all of this stuff is being memorized and repeated over and over around the world and 5 times a day of prayer. It's beautiful, but it's like it's not the language of the people. And so God put it in John Wycliffe's heart, and he translated the scriptures out of Latin into vernacular English, and it caused a revolution. And later his bones got dug up, moved out of the churchyard, and burned. And then William Tyndale, he left England, went to Switzerland, and translated the scriptures out of the Greek and Hebrew into English. They were smuggled back into England. He was also burned at the stake. His last words were, "May God open the eyes of the King of England." And God answered that prayer. How about that? Seen any royal weddings in the last few years? You know, I mean, it's like the gospel's being preached. There's been a revolution in the royal family concerning the gospel just in the last 10 years. The houses of parliament have never had as many devoted Christians as they do presently in anyone's memory. There's something going on that's not getting in the newspapers. But God is on the move, and he changes nations, and translating is a big part of that. Now, some of you, maybe you were Wycliffe or New Tribe translators, but I'm telling you, some of you are translating because you're coming up with new ways to communicate the gospel. We're going to put it in an action comic book, or we're going to put it online in a video game. Those are ways of translating into something that will reach people who otherwise wouldn't get it. That's why, do you understand? Because they translated the Bible into English, English now is the lingua franca of the whole world, much to the chagrin of French speakers. But it's like, you know, when an airplane lands today in Riyadh, Saudi Arabia, or in Ulaanbaatar, Mongolia, the tower and the pilot are both speaking English. It's the standard language. The United Nations business is conducted in English. Why did this happen? It's the fruit of people that gave their lives for the gospel. Not that English is necessarily better than any other language, but it's just, and it goes on and on and on. People who wrote books and rewrote books, and they came up with stories that transformed the imaginations of an entire culture. We're reaping the benefit of that. John Bunyan wrote Pilgrim's Progress mostly in jail. It became a bestseller all over England, and Pilgrim became the new hero who replaced Odysseus and all the Greek stories and the tricksters and the superheroes of Greek and Roman mythology, Norse mythology, and Pilgrim became this godly heroic figure that young people wanted to be like when they grew up. It's hard for us to imagine because it's so different than our current culture, but it was 16th century, and it was so different, it caught on like wildfire, and it set the stage for revival and great awakening in England. Okay, so here we are. We're going like music, creativity, technology, the power of translation, the power of media. Some of you are storytellers. Some of you are novelists. Some of you are movie makers. Go for it. Go for it. Go for it. And then there's the whole idea of science and education. In the Christian West, the universities were established. And despite what you might hear about universities in India and China, they were very minor. They've kind of been pumped up by people that are sort of anti-Western civ to sound like they were great. But the great universities that developed in Europe, they developed out of a respect for learning and science. The church was never against science. You know, there's so much propaganda that we get fed, you know, but it's like the great universities were founded by missionaries, by people that were on fire for God. Harvard was founded to train people for the ministry. The Sorbonne, Oxford, Cambridge, they were centered around chapels where people worshiped and prayed. And it just, I mean, it's like, what happened? Why did this develop in the West? Because the Bible tells us that in the beginning was the Word. And the Word makes sense. And the world was created in order. And so if we study the universe, we'll discover secrets that no one's made. And this drove scientific exploration and the high value of education. Some of you are educators, right? Okay, I know you're getting tired here. So, I just know it's physiological, okay? Morality and prosperity, wherever the gospel goes, people, like, how many of you, you don't have to raise your hands, you can if you want, but how many of you, before you met Jesus, it didn't bother you at all to take a little extra? Or take, you know, thieves, liars, extortioners, you know, don't raise your hands in case the statute of limitation isn't over. But it's something like, after you meet Jesus, you're like, I don't want to do that anymore. That's wrong. And it's like inside we now have the Holy Spirit, the breath of God that's making us holy, not from external threat and rules, but from an internal guidance that is in that seed is the blessing of the nations. And so wherever morality increases, crime goes down, corruption goes down, and prosperity is released because people trust each other. Their word is their bond. No one is swindling. I'm telling you, some of you are called to business, and that way that you bring the kingdom into business is part of releasing the blessing of God and making the nations glad. And then there's this whole issue of family. Only the gospel reveals monogamous marriage, one man, one woman with children, so that every child has a father and a mother. They know who they are. It's under attack right now in our wider culture, but that will be temporary. And that will be temporary. And some of you have a burden for family, and I just want to commission you to go for it. But isn't it strange that wherever the gospel goes, this pattern of honoring marriage and honoring family gets reestablished or established for the first time? Then there's compassion for the poor. Oh my gosh. Every time there's a big disaster anywhere in the world, like, all this aid comes from Christian countries or countries that have been impacted by a Christian culture, even though the president may be corrupt, the legislature may be corrupt, the prime minister may be corrupt, but the culture of the country says we need to help the poor. We need to help these people in trouble. And then actually medicine comes out of the gospel. The story of the Good Samaritan who stopped and took care of somebody that he didn't have any responsibility for. Jesus, who said that we're responsible to use our lives to help others. Out of this came the whole impulse for medicine and medical missions. We've gone around the world. We have some people from this church who've gone around establishing hospitals in nations that are not Christian nations. Like, why are you doing that? And it's all done through voluntary donations, making the nations glad. All right, last one is liberty. We can thank God. I mean, you know, certainly liberty can run amok. How many know? I mean, when Paul said, don't use your liberty as an occasion to indulge the flesh, but use it to glorify God, to serve one another. How many know that liberty can be used as an occasion for the flesh? All you have to do is read any magazine or the headlines on the magazine racks at the grocery store. It's disgusting. But I'm telling you, the alternative would be even worse. Like, have you noticed that there's not a huge wall being built around Saudi Arabia trying to keep people from getting into paradise? I mean, I'm not trying to be a wise guy here, and I'm not weighing in on very touchy subjects, but I'm just saying that wherever the gospel is having an impact on a culture, people want to move there. Because the nation is glad. So should we keep them all out or should we welcome them in?
You pray about it. Okay, I'm gonna let you pray about that. But at this moment, we want to receive the offering, okay? Because this is going to change the world. Are you happy about it? I hope so. Okay. I feel like I'm this. You know, I'm doing a promotion here or something, and I'm not. But I mean, the gospel is so powerful. Are the ushers ready? Now, do you know how to give? Maybe we could flash the thing up there again. Okay, there's a special envelope in your bulletins if you got them today, but you can give by PayPal or PushPay, not PayPal, PushPay, and you just flip the little thing to missions. We know what it's for. You can write a check to Life Center. You can give by credit card or cash on those envelopes. But here's what we're asking. It's just that you would do what God has impressed on your heart to do, that this would be out of joy that you give. And here's what you're actually doing. You're planting a seed into the transformation of the world. And maybe, just maybe, you're going to plant a redwood or a giant sequoia with that offering that seems so small to you, that's going to go on for the next 1,000 years, bringing amazing change in the world. Are you ready? If you present your offering, actually, don't hold it up, just hold it to your heart. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to change the world, to make the nations glad, and to be empowered ourselves through participation in this process of discipling the nations. Would you, Jesus, would you take these offerings like you took the loaves and fishes? And would you break it and bless it and distribute it and bring about a filling of the earth with your kindness, with the message of the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ? And would you release the multiplication of seed to the sowers as we sow today, God, that there'd always be more to sow into every good work. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Ushers, if you would go ahead and serve so well. Isn't it amazing? We think, Matthew 14, we have only. We always think in limitation. That's human nature. And Jesus says, just bring it to me. And then everything's going to be all right. You know, he changes our fear to his faith. It's amazing. And through that, he changes the world. You guys are amazing and generous. Would you stand up? I just feel like you've been sitting for too long. I should have had you stand up in the middle. So I want to pray for every one of you that you receive divine blessing back for the offering you've given today. That I want to pray for you that the God of hope would fill you with all peace and all joy as you trust him, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you would overflow with hope. That's what the power of the Holy Spirit does in our lives, right? Today is Trinity Sunday. It's the Father's gift sent by Jesus to dwell in us, the Holy Spirit, so that we would overflow with hope by his power. Do you want that? I just want you to lift your hands. Holy Spirit, we can't do anything without your empowering grace. We can't do anything without Jesus, who brings us to the Father and makes us sons and daughters. Would you fill us today? Would you fill us today with all joy and all peace, with great trust and expectation? Would you make us, armor us with the shield of faith so that newspaper headlines don't distress us, but just stir us up to pray and contend? Thank you, God, that you will fill the whole world with your glory. I said I'd give an altar call today for people that are miserable, that But I'll also give the altar call for people that just want more joy, want more power, want to be empowered. And I just want to empower you in these areas that I've mentioned that we change the world, that you'll be released in technology, in creativity, in language, in education, in science, in business, in morality, and in championing the family, that you'll be released and you'll be a powerful missionary where you are. So Holy Spirit, would you come and release your commissioning on your people? May the Lord bless you, keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance upon you and give you his shalom as you bear his name into the world. Amen, amen. God bless you and have a great week. So, if you want prayer for joy or you want prayer for healing, there is healing here today. There is always healing here, but there's healing here today. Please come up.